Look, Josh, absolute pleasure to chat with you once again. It's been, let's say, a crazy couple of, well, almost couple of years now, but one thing that's come out great out of this time is that there's been some absolutely incredible releases that have come out, and you're back with this L.I.F.E. project. I want to make sure that I'm saying it right, by the way, because it is abbreviated and, you know, we're so it is the L.I.F.E. project,
It is
yeah?
the L.I.F.E. project, yeah.
And, you
I'm
know,
not going into details of what that acronym is yet. I want to
Okay,
have
fair
some fun with it because I want to see what other people come up with for better or for worse.
For sure, man. Well, the one thing that I'm taking away from it is it's an incredible new direction that you're going in. It's out in July. The guys have got to hear a couple of pieces from it so far. Now, how did this come to be?
Well, I mean, I'm constantly writing music. Anyway, really, it all started at the end of 19, I guess, or the beginning of 19. I started working on some new stuff. I had built a new home studio in my new house, and just started working on music. And then ended up talking to Corey. Corey was like, "Hey, I'm going to do a solo record in between these Slipknot records this time." And I just basically was like, "Well, I can't necessarily just sit around for, I don't even know how long it could possibly be. I mean, 6 years, maybe. I don't know. I mean, none of us know." So I was just like, "Well, I can't wait for Stone Sour to come back around. I have all these ideas, and I'm really right now hit this whole new, like, I'm in a very creative space over the last year. And I think it's just having this new studio and just, you know, being sober for the first time, you know, in a long time for writing." So I just decided I'll just do my own thing then. You know, it's been quite a challenge because I'm doing like every aspect pretty much myself. So, but it's been fun.
Well, I mean, it certainly sounds like it. I mean, I was wondering if it was a bit of a, well, to me, it was like a chicken and the egg kind of situation, you know, whether or not these tracks had already inspired, you know, a female direction. You know, you kind of thought, actually, I want a little bit more of that sensibility, you know, from Cassandra, or whether or not it was working with her that actually inspired this new direction. How did it actually come about?
Well, I've always known if I ever stepped out of Stone Sour that it would be female fronted. I just felt like I write a certain way. It's, you know, you're going to hear those similarities. Well, it's, you know, it's like, well, I'm a huge part of writing in Stone Sour. So it's like, I'm not just going to wake up and play guitar completely different after playing for 30 years. So I thought, you know, by having a great female vocalist, not only one, does it open up the door for me to possibly musically go into different directions that I would never bring that stuff into Stone Sour, but also just so that individual didn't get the comparison of against, you know, obviously Corey, which would just be unfair. So I think there's several things that I had in the back of my mind of why it would be female fronted. And then I
Yeah.
found this amazing singer 5 hours south of me, and I was just like, that's the voice. I mean, it was like, yeah.
I mean, that is the thing, isn't it? Because, you know, a lot of people can sing, you know what I mean? Like you can get someone who can technically do it. But man, this record is, I mean, the EP, I should say, to give it its proper title, has some moments where it's just proper hairs standing up. Now that must have been the same for you. I mean, obviously it's your music, so you don't want to be too like, oh, this is the fucking best thing ever, I get it. But there must have been some moments in there where you just thought, my God, this vocalist is one of a kind.
Yeah, she's amazing. And the crazy thing is, really all her vocal passes for this EP were kind of her scratch vocals.
Wow.
You know, initially we were going to go back and re-record everything. And then once I got into a position where I'm like, okay, you know what? We're just going to do it ourselves. Because at the time last year, it was like, and granted, I don't blame the label's faults, but I couldn't sit on my hands any longer. It was like nobody wanted to sign anything because obviously the state of the world. And it's like, well, I've been sitting on these songs for over a year. I need to get them out. So once I decided, hey, let's just put this stuff out, you know, it sounds great. It's, and I think the cool thing is because we're loose on it because we didn't have any idea that we were actually going to release what we recorded, which I think is cool. You know, it really stood up in my mind of, you know, obviously you always think back after you put something out or whatever of changing a part, but overall, I just felt like the vibe was there and it sounded great. And I wanted to start laying the groundwork for this band for us to move forward and just to move on from these songs for myself. Like I said, we had already been sitting on basically these five songs for almost a year at that point. And we have 13. But wow. Like I said, this was going into this, I knew we would put this out and this would just be an introduction to everybody. We're not going to tour this EP. We probably won't do that until next year. And then hopefully either there'll be a second EP or a full length. My goal is first quarter next year. And at that point, then we'll be a complete band and go out and hopefully tour.
That's super exciting and great to hear that there's more coming, because that's the way it is these days, isn't it? You know what it's like, even from every other record you've done. As soon as the first one's out, it's like, when's the next one? So, once it's great, people want to hear more. It's a good sign, I guess. People want to hear more.
Absolutely.
Now, the thing that really stands out for me, obviously, there's obviously great playing from you every album that you put out, great tones. But before we get into that specifically, this album is particularly cinematic in terms of like just wall of sounds. And I don't know, a lot of the time, I just feel as if it would just fit with a film, you know, or like so much more than some of the other music. How did you end up going in that direction? And was that something specifically that you were looking to create?
Well, yeah, in a lot of ways, I try to write with a lot of dynamics. I love the pushing and pulling and, taking the listener on a journey. Everything I usually write, and I've always had written, it's, you can tell even with all the Stone Sour stuff, if there's like tempo changes and feel changes throughout the entire thing, then more than likely that I contributed to that, you know, to that song. I mean, so it's just naturally how I write. The thing that changed this time around is for the first time I was able to actually add a lot of the layering and texturing, you know, or ear candy, however you whatever person sure. wants to describe all that stuff, instead of just being guitar, bass, and drums, you know, adding all this extra stuff because technology's come around. I'm not a great piano or keyboard player by any means, and I can usually like hack my way through it, but because of technology being where it is, I was able to also get the sounds. I mean, there's just libraries of stuff that nowadays it's just days to go through all that stuff. I mean, I literally sat down on a couple times and just spent a day going through, you know, I would play it and it would record it MIDI. Then I would try to go find the exact sound that I wanted. And I'd spend like forever. Cause I mean, it's like 10,000, you know, sounds and this and that, but that was the biggest, I think, difference for me in writing the Life Project stuff versus everything I've done up to Stone Sour. Cause usually when it's just, you know, for Stone Sour, it's, I give drums, bass, and guitar, and then that's it. And then I turn that over to Corey, and then Corey will write the lyrics, we'll make any adjustments. And when both of us are happy with it, then that's when we turn it over to the other guys to put their own flavor on it.
Did you write the lyrics on this as well?
I helped on a couple of tracks. I come from the school of thought. It's really, for me, it's important kind of for the singer to write the lyrics. And the reason why I say that is because then it's their own words that they're conveying. And I just think there's just a different, I just think it's better. I think you get a better performance if that person, because like I said, they're the ones that wrote the words that they're singing and the melodies. So I'm not saying that there's not other bands. Obviously there's a ton of bands that, you know, have out, you know, other guys write lyrics and then people sing it. But, that's just my belief. I thought it was really important for her to write the majority of the lyrics. And then I would just kind of help or say, hey, what do you think about this or that?
Yeah. Yeah, well, it definitely shines through, that's for sure. Now, I touched there on, you know, some of the great playing that's going on there. Talk us through some of the gear that you were using on this record.
It's really, so for bass, it was Sean Economaki's Stone Sour bassist, the original bassist, his Fender P anniversary. He had given it to me because he said I needed a good bass. So, which the thing sounds incredible. So it was pretty much that and a Billy Sheehan Attitude 3 for bass. And then it was direct. We used a Sans amp, DI. We used a tone hammer. We used a bunch of dark glass stuff. And that was pretty much the bass tone. Guitar was an RG, Ibanez RG, and an RGA with a Sustainiac, which is really weird because I have all these custom guitars, and these were the two guitars they sent me that were production models from last year, because one of them has the Evertune bridge with Fishman's, and then the other one had the Sustainiac, which I've been wanting to mess with forever. I actually ended up getting finally my Chrome Boy that I ordered like 3 years ago, but I don't really play that too much as Satriani is like a huge influence on me, but obviously we look similar. So it's just like, I don't need to read 200 comments of how we look like one another. It's like, yeah, well, but.
Well, you can just say you don't want to get fingerprints on it. You know, it's as simple as that. It's interesting. I mean, I knew that you were a Satch fan anyway, but I feel like on Ignite, that solo has got, it's got tons of Satch over it. You know, plenty of you, obviously, right. But you know, it's always nice to hear, like, just like when you hear Satriani and you sometimes hear Hendrix flavors and all that he brings into it. It's always nice to put a little nod to that. I take it that's just in you now. You know, you don't set out to do that. It's, I guess it's just you write the solos and that's how they come out. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, I think with me, you hear that Satriani Gilbert Vi, and I'm always usually playing exotic scales. It's usually very Eastern sounding just because that's what I like. It doesn't surprise me to hear a little bit, you know, of taking that influence into my own style, because that's how I learned how to play. I was trying to play like those guys' stuff. And so I think what I have taken the most from them, is in, like, my guitar solos are almost like what the verses would be like for those guys in their songs. And what I mean by that, it's very, usually I try to be very melodic and very singing songwriter, with the melody and stuff, and not flash and just, you know, here's 20 seconds of me trying to play as fast as I can. I always try to make it, like I said, it's almost like their influence on me is just making it melodic and singable. Even though, you know, obviously both of those guys are like, or all three of those guys are like aliens, truly. But I mean, that's what I try to do. Is
there much improvisation when it comes to writing solos for you? Or do you like to kind of structure it all?
I'm very structured, usually. You have those happy accidents that happen, you know, but the solo itself is... always pretty much written out, you know. On World on Fire, I got that weird harmonic with the trim on one pass, and that wasn't planned. It just happened, but then it was like, oh, it's cool, so we'll leave it. Then I had to try to double it, which that was fun. it was just one of those moments that's like, how the hell did that happen, you know? And it's just like, oh, cool, you know. But
well, you know, I think that is the thing, though. It's a very interesting thing for, you know, from a guitar player's perspective, is that, you know, sometimes people can play a lot of notes. You play a lot of notes in a solo, but it's memorable, you know. And some people, it's quite forgettable. And you can remember. I can remember from the very first time the first Stone Sour single came out, and you got that pick and run on there, you know. And it's still in my mind, you know, like that. You know, even to this day. So, you know, when did that penny drop for you that, look, I want to show off some technique here, you know, I want to serve the song ultimately, but obviously a solo is time to shine, getting that balance right and structuring it so that it is memorable for the listener?
I actually have to credit an owner of a studio here in Des Moines. When I was younger and I first started playing, I like back in the day, I was playing seriously between 4 to 6 hours a day easily. And my focus was like doing all, you know, like Paul Gilbert, play this until it sounds like a popsicle stick and, you know, bicycle spokes. And I literally, everybody will tell you like, and how much I used to practice all that. So then I went into the studio to play on a song, and I was like 17 or 18. And the owner of the studio is, I played the solo and he's like, is that it? And I was like, you know, I'm all proud. It's like, you know, I'm playing like a couple 16 note runs, maybe even a 30 second note. I snuck in into a place and he's like, doesn't do anything for me. It's not melodic. You're not saying anything. So what? You can play fast. It doesn't work. And it really actually stuck with me after that. So then all of a sudden I went from trying to cram all these crazy things as fast as I could play in to just letting stuff breathe and just be singable. And the more I thought about it, it's like, shit, a couple of my favorite solos, that's what they are. Like, how epic is Detroit Rock City by Kiss, you know? And everybody hums the solo, or you know, or Motley Crue Home Sweet Home, how it's there's no flash there, but it fits the song. And it's just, so I always try to kind of base it off that for me, regardless of how fast it is, you know, the song is, it's just try to make it memorable. And
absolutely,
like I said, you want to go watch a bunch of people play crazy stuff and go on YouTube and watch somebody do 10 finger tapping and they're probably 12 years old. And it's just blows my mind. Some of the stuff that these kids post, I'm just like, what the hell? Like, yeah. It's insane to me. But
just touching on that a little bit more about, you know, the fact these solos can be so memorable, and the fact that you are such a big Satch and Vi fan, where do you think they shine like that? Like in solo sections of largely instrumental tracks, are there some key moments from them where you think that is such the perfect guitar solo, even though it's in amongst an instrumental track?
I mean, for them, I think, I mean, especially with Steve Vai, I mean, for the love of God, is like that guitar solo is insane. It's just even with as shreddy as it is, you know, and how technical it is, it's just ridiculous. It's like perfect. You know, what is the other stuff from him? I mean, honestly, all Passion and Warfare to me. With Satriani, crying off of The Extremist was a huge song for me. And just the feel of it, like, it's like, oh, you listen to it. And I remember getting the Tab book when it finally came out. And I was just like, oh, yeah. And it's not necessarily hard. I mean, it's hard to play in the sense of the feel of what, how he plays it. Like I can play it, but it doesn't come across like when he plays it. And it's kind of frustrating. There's just that feel there. And so I think that was a huge one for me too, was trying to learn that. And that, like I said, it's not overcomplicated with the notes. It's just it's complicated by getting the conviction and the feel that he wrote that song with.
Absolutely. No, you couldn't have picked two better examples for sure. There would have probably been the same from me. You know, I can't not speak to you today and not touch a little bit on Stone Sour, especially from the fact that we're approaching this 20th anniversary of that first record, which is absolutely incredible. Just reflecting on that time period and looking back to that, all good memories.
It's all good memories. I mean, for me, it was all new. And for everybody else, it wasn't, because obviously Jim and Corey were in Slipknot. Sean was working for Slipknot. Joel had played out a bunch. For me, Stone Sour is all I know. So Corey and myself really actually wrote that, almost all that first album, just the two of us, prior to it rounding out with the rest of the guys. So it was very exciting and not knowing what was going to happen. And then all of a sudden it's like, I had never played out before. So my first show is a Stone Sour show here in Des Moines. And it was, obviously we sold the show out. We had tons of people in the parking lot. I was scared shitless. 'Cause it's just like, oh my God, talk about pressure. No. And then I just, everything that came with it, making the record, being in the studio, the surreal, going out to film the Get Inside video at the Whiskey A Go-Go, which to me, obviously I grew up with, you know, loving a lot of the hair metal bands. So of course that was a legendary place that you read about in all these magazines back in the day. So yeah, I mean, it was great and being able to tour the world. So I look back on it and it's crazy to me that it's been that long, but yeah, it's been an amazing journey.
And did the Whiskey live up to the hype?
What's that?
Did the playing the Whiskey live up to the hype?
Yeah, it was crazy. It was, I didn't think the stage was going to be that small, I'll be honest. It's very tight in that place. But, you know, like I said, everybody and their brothers basically played there, from, you know, the Doors to Motley Crue, of course, all the hair metal bands from the early 80s. So yeah, it was awesome.
And obviously I don't want to fuck you off talking about Stone Sour stuff, but you know, it's, you are, you know, the, you know, such a huge part of that band, and it's just gone away, you know, and we want to see it back, obviously. Is that likely to happen?
I don't know at this point. I mean, the reality is this: I'm doing what I'm doing. Corey's doing his solo thing. There'll be a new Slipknot record. I think it will whenever the time is right. Like, we'll know when it's time to come back to it. It definitely, I do think that we needed to all step away from it. But to give a timeline for a return or anything, I have no idea.
See, for me, you know, listening to the record, obviously being a fan of Stone Sour and your yourself for such a long time, you know, I hear a track like Purgatory, you know, and I see that as, you know, even more personal than maybe it is. I don't know, but, you know, I was wondering if that was a reflection of how you felt during that period.
You're talking about the EP?
On the EP, yeah.
No, I mean, for me, it was just me playing with where I'm at. I mean, it's not really a reflection on anything. It's, if anything, it's just more of doing my vision, you know, without,
sure.
Obviously it's different when it's all of us. So, and everybody's opinion, you know, counts and we listen to everything, but it's really not a reflection back on that. It's just where I'm currently at.
Sure.
And the fact that with me, it's a little bit different because I'm just writing music for the most part. So, you know, I guess it might be different if I was writing the lyrics, but I'm not. So it's, you know, a riff.
Yeah, I'm definitely not insinuating there's any diss tracks or some nonsense like that, you know, but
right.
It's obviously a very personal record. And you know, you look into it deeper. Last thing on Stone Sour, mate, is just you did mention these demos. I mean, are they going to come out?
The demos?
The demos from last year that you mentioned, that the unreleased music for Stone Sour.
You know, there was talk about it. I don't think so at this point. I think it'll just be what is on YouTube. I mean, to really make physical copies of any of that stuff, I don't think any of us feel like it's up to par to really actually release and charge people for. That's one of the reasons why I pushed to do what I did last year, was like, we have this stuff. It'd be cool for people to hear it. I don't want to charge people for what it is. I mean, so, you know, I don't know. Like I said, there's really no plans of us doing anything at this point. There's been no discussion of anything. We were going to do a 10th anniversary of Audio Secrecy last year, but obviously COVID threw a massive wrench into that, which would have been cool. But yeah, I don't think there's going to be anything new for a while.
Okay. But there's no bad fight.
No, I mean, it's just everybody's doing different stuff. And if we can't like support it and push for it, then it's kind of like, well, it wouldn't make sense to do any
It makes sense. You can't tour it, you know, even with the live project, you know, like, you know, I'm sure you're keen to get that out on the road when you finally can with the new music. Just before I let you go, Josh, because I know you're very busy today, you had, you're the type of musician that's always looking to just keep expanding their knowledge, you know, and you can hear that in every new release that you do. What's been your takeaways from your recent return back to music college and getting your master's? You know, has that been a good experience for you?
Well, I always think you can grow. I still have one more class that I need to take. I keep putting it off. It's like I have this discussion about, oh, did you get your master's yet? And it's like, nah, I still haven't taken that last class, which is jazz 101, because I know it's going to be hard. It's just, you know, it's completely opposite of how I play. But I'm always big on trying to learn new stuff, because otherwise then your stuff just becomes, you know, you just keep repeating yourself in some ways. Like I said, my big inspiration on the live project stuff really was the addition of being able to add all these keyboard parts and piano parts. You know, actually I wrote one, two, I think there's actually four piano songs that we've recorded. Obviously there's only going to be one on the EP.
Yeah.
But yeah, there's actually four songs. So I think that is like my new, where I really draw the inspiration and kind of get a mess around with, like, cause I really don't know what I'm doing. So there's like no rules to me. Mm. So it's just, there's a different found freedom in it because of that. Like with guitar, sometimes I'll be like, yeah, well, technically by theory, this shouldn't work. Or I overthink stuff. I think it's easy for people to do that. Once you start learning some stuff and then all of a sudden, knowledge is great, but it can also, in my opinion, hinder you depending on your thought process of how you use that knowledge. You know, I now just try to go with what feels right. I don't try to think about, you know, what key this is in and is this proper and blah, 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 because sometimes that isn't what it should be, even though technically it is, but.
I get you for sure. Well, that's it. You want to learn it and then you want to not be held down by it while you're too busy doing it. You know, you want to be too busy doing it. You're not thinking about the ins and outs. Well, that's what the greats do anyway. I'd you know, I'd love to crack it myself. Look, Josh, absolute pleasure to chat with you. Congratulations on this new release. It's gonna do brilliant. And I can't wait till you get to play live again in the UK. Maybe next year.
Yeah, that's what I'm hoping. Like I said, right now we'll put out this EP. I think this fall we're going to release a couple of covers just for fun that we actually recorded these covers kind of as I don't want to say an audition for Cassandra. It's more of just seeing how well we work together. So I'm thinking I might just go ahead and we might just throw those out for fun just because we already have them and it's just kind of fills the gap in between that and the next, hopefully release early next year and touring.
Beautiful. Well, I can't wait to hear that. Josh, thanks again. Have a great day.
You too. Thanks for having me.
All right, man. Bye.
Bye.